Good evening, everybody, and thanks for the opportunity to speak to you today. What I would like to talk is cyber risk in the financial sector in the age of digitalization. And I would like to give you a brief overview about the actors and the threats, but also the responsibilities, and later on followed by an overview of potential insurance solutions from two different perspectives. One would be from a commercial perspective, but the other one would be from a retail and individual perspective. When it comes to digitalization, I mean, within the next 3 years, so to say, the number of internet users will increase significantly from currently 3.5 million internet users globally. We will see in 3 years' time almost 40% more of them, which means 5 billion of internet users. Having that in mind, in a rather stable population, this will certainly have a significant impact on, let's say, our behavior. More and more usage of messengers, but also more and more connected worlds like smart home, like industry 4.0, which means smart factory and things like that. So we will see a huge increase in IT dependency. But also, when it comes to IT dependency, more and more connected devices will be in place. I mean, having a look to the slide, almost 56% more connected devices in almost 4 years' time. Where does it come from? Certainly a huge portion of that are the Internet of Things. And having that in mind, Internet of Things devices are the most vulnerable devices currently. So 70% of the IoT devices currently are not really secure. And taking the IT connectivity into account, taking the increased number of devices, but also the volume of data we share, also not only with messengers and social media presence, but a significant increase of 175% of increase in data volume brings certainly a huge challenge for the IT industry to store certain data, but also the exposure to security data is very important. And data is a new fuel for the digitalization. And data itself, we deem it as a non-physical asset which needs to be protected. And not only the IT dependency and the data dependency increases, also our behavior, how we pay, changes significantly over the time. What's the reason for that? I mean, here in India, one of the speakers beforehand spoke about the demonetization which took place, I guess, on the 8th of November 2016, if I remember correctly, is one of the reasons why, let's say, the physical cards and money certainly decrease, but on the other hand, also the next generation of the population more addicted to the internet, more addicted to smartphones and applications, and also the willingness to take a certain risk and to pay via smartphones, via applications, is certainly increasing. So a behavioral change, but also the demonetization leads to a change in our payment transaction. And wherever is money in the old times, let's say the physical money, in the new times, the digital money, there is also some other who look for your money, not always with the right things in mind. And what I mean with that are certainly the cyber criminals. And taking a look also from a development perspective, again, this would be one of the last percentages which I would like to present and figures, and I would like to come later on to facts. But the figures around the cyber, the costs of cybercrime will significantly increase also within the next 4 years from 450 billion to 6,000 billion US dollar. And what's it all about? It's theft of financial money. It's certainly also in different industries, theft of intellectual property, and so on. So a significant increase of cost in cybercrime. And who so far are the actors in this space? And I'm deliberately only focusing on the financial sector in this respect. And if you have a look to that slide, the blue colored. So what's in the financial sector the most dominant actors, and certainly the organized crime. So roughly 40% of the actors are coming out of the scene of the organized crime with a clear focus, stealing money and gaining financial benefit out of certain hacking. Also, in the financial sector, if you look to the opportunistic hackers, it's a large portion, but with a different motivation. And certainly, the impact of such kind of hacking more results in a data corruption and sometimes also business corruption due to a security failure. But the financial loss, so to say, from stealing of money is most dominant with the organized crime. So that's all about potential actors, but where does the actors come from? And certainly not always the criminal from outside. As you see, also the internal actors, so to say. On one hand, is it on an accidental base, which means an error? It takes over 41% of the incidents are the cause any internal error. But also former or disgraced employees are actors which have a different motivation. That's from an actor perspective when it comes to what kind of really actors are around the organized crime, but also from an internal perspective how we see in the financial sector the threat actors. In a more general way, and allow me to spend a few words to the threat landscape in general. Threat landscape, if you just remember a slight time journey. End of 2016, everything was all about DDoS attacks, at least the large attacks was all about DDoS. The first two quarters of 2017, we saw a significant increase in threats coming from ransomware. I mean, the biggest example around WannaCry, Petya, not Petya, and so on. And walking around the third quarter of 2017, the majority of the threats we have seen came again from the data breach, and the largest data breach around Equifax and Deloitte. And later on in October, it was coming back from a threat perspective against ransomware with BadRabbit. So it's always a changing threat landscape, and so also the cybersecurity has to significantly and quite rapidly adjust to the threat sectors. And so you see on the right-hand side that also the cybersecurity spending increased significantly by more than 35 times in 13 years. And one portion going forward will certainly be also the cyber insurance solution, but the majority of the investments around cybersecurity are in the security controls. And data breach, I mean, having an exposure of almost 65% of all available data worldwide, which were exposed to a data breach recently, gives us a significant overview how dangerous the threat landscape is all about. And again, I close with that when it comes to ransomware and to a cross-industrial sector perspective. The losses, so to say, just out of ransomware up to June 2017 were roughly 5 billion, and we're expecting by the year end around 8 to 9 billion, just around losses in global ransomware. The minority of that are certainly currently not insured, but going forward with an increased take-up of insurance policies, we will more and more see insured losses which need to be handled in a proper way. Coming back to the financial sector and what could be potential targets for actors. An actor, as we said before, around the organized crime, always looking for the weakest link in a system. And how complex, I mean, you are the expert in this respect when it comes to financial transactions and how complex the banking system is that coming from a top from the customers and along the whole value chain of transactions to the core of the bank, of the ATMs, and a threat actor will always look for the weakest point in this link, and certainly once he is in, he will find his way. And it depends on the motivation of the actors. But certainly, if you talk about organized crime, but also if you talk about espionage in this context around advanced persistent threats, the main target going forward will be the bank and the ATMs. And what are ATM? And further weak links could mean, I will come to that in a second, just focusing on ATM and later on SWIFT. having an ATM, I mean, I would divide it in three categories from potential threats when it comes to ATM. First of all, on the left corner with the ATM skinning, that's something where somewhere could come devices into ATMs in order to collect data. And we believe that the main responsibility to have a look when it comes to an ATM, if it's a proper set of ATM, lies with the consumer. The liability is also, and the target is here just to collect data and use this data later on. But if you and me go to an ATM, everyone has to have a look if there's really anything of skimming or not. So it's our responsibility if we withdraw cash to also have a look what kind of devices we are using. Certainly the bank has a liability as well, but I would believe the majority of the liability when it comes to ATM skimming lies with the consumer. But there are two other threat vectors when it comes to ATMs. It's all about the malware. And malware from, let's say, having a physical attack, like connecting via USB or whatever to an ATM machine and providing the malware, and further on get the cash out of the ATM. And the third one, the third dimension besides ATM skimming and the physical attack, is obviously the network attack, and always here also around the malware, getting the malware into the system and further on to gain access to certain systems and withdraw cash. And that's just an overview of incidents in the financial sector, specifically when it comes to India. And I would not like to go into details, but the majority of the incidents, so to say, especially in the financial sector, is all about the ATMs and malware. And as you also see, phishing takes place as well in this large incident. And when it comes to phishing, it's all about the social engineering and how we or ourselves expose us in social media, what kind of information we give to the public, which certain actors can use, and why social engineering finds the right point into an organization and finds its way later on into systems. So the main incidents with a bigger volume, so to say, is all about ATMs, but also intrusion into networks when it comes to malware. Having a look to the financial institutions itself, but also to customers, but customers of financial institutions more in the commercial sector. I would say risk assessment is really key to get an idea and to limit the own exposure. And when we talk about risk assessment from an insurance perspective, we believe, first of all, the most important is to identify. And what we mean with identify, having an idea, what are my critical assets? And as I said before, assets in the 2017 and the future are all about the non-physical assets like data. So what are my critical data? What are my critical systems? If I identify them, I can also put some measures in place to protect them. And with protection, certainly security controls, I mean malware protection, a firewall and so on, but also having right patch management in place, a lot of more security controls. But if I'm not aware of and have not classified my assets, I won't protect the right assets in the right way. So it's all about identification, protection, and also being closely monitoring and detecting any intrusions. And then once a third party who shouldn't have access is in your system, then it's all about to respond, especially in the case of a data breach, but also to recover in the case of a security failure, unauthorized access, and having a proper business continuity plan in place, which also takes care not only of some NatCat events, but also of cyber events. And finally, the last layer of defense is quite important, because each of the prior layer certainly leaves some risk gaps. And the last layer of defense from a commercial perspective is the cyber insurance policy. And just small journey into the insurance world. But I think it's important also in the context of cyber risk and cyber threats. So just in case the attack was successful, so the security controls in place were not successful, but the attack itself, he went into the system, has an intrusion, and there are certain scenarios where he gains benefit. Certainly theft of funds, but also certain further consequences for the financial institutions might be interruption to business operation, which leads to a loss of profit and things like that. And if you see on the right-hand side the boxes, that's potential coverage element which takes care of the consequences of a successful attack. And from our point of view, the first thing is about the IT services, which is part of a proper cyber insurance policy. What I mean with IT services is having experts who are already doing everything to close the vulnerability, just to avoid that the actor comes in again. And it's not about just risk transfer. In the nowadays, insurance policy is by far more than just risk transfer. So services around IT services, around crisis management, also from a reputational perspective, are key to really limit the downside once the actor was successful. And I would not like to bore you further with insurance, but just how complex insurance currently could be, because already existing insurance policies are in place. Let's say a property policy which protects certain assets from a physical perspective, like content and building, but also the consequences like a business interruption. Other policies like liabilities dealing with claims from outside, so a third party sues you and a liability policy would respond. It's, let's say, when the policies were designed, no one intensively thought about cyber crime and cyber access from outside and things like that. So currently it's a quite variety of products in place which partly take some cyber risks and provide coverage for cyber risks. But from our point of view, the future will be having a standalone and tailored cyber solution which tackles all relevant cyber risks from a physical damage perspective, from a non-physical damage perspective, and the consequences out of that, but also, as said before, tackling the services which are needed to limit any potential downside. Having talked about the financial institutions itself from a risk assessment and potential insurance solutions, the customer of everyone, from a bank, the individual customer, the retail customer, but also the commercial customer, are always key to provide them with proper solutions and also to protect them for things which they are not responsible for. And I think the Reserve Bank of India has a clear liability statement, so to say, when it comes to unauthorized transaction. And just forgetting for the time being the commercial world, just focusing on the individual. So like an individual like you and me gets a victim of an unauthorized electronic banking transaction. Certainly, zero liability lies with me if I can prove any negligence on the bank side, but also if I'm let's say reporting the incident from unauthorized transactions in 3 days. But there's a certain liability also for Indian individuals when it comes, when their own have a negligent behavior. So if the individual acts negligent, having a not secured smartphone and things like that, leaving maybe the smartphone on a table and going somewhere else, there's a certain negligence behavior obvious and also a certain liability. And going forward, you will see more and more insurance policies also for individuals in place who takes care of this liability gap. So on one hand, there is zero liability if negligence is with the bank, but if the negligence is with the consumer, then a personal line cyber would fill this gap. And how it could look like, I would like to show you this overview. And it's not about, because the majority of the motivation to buy such kind of personal lines or retail cyber certain lies on the left-hand side with the third part around the online fraud. So any theft of money due to online transactions and things like that, personal line cyber policy will take care. But the actors are not only coming from a financial motivation, also other motivations. On one hand, with the more and more internet presence of children, for instance, but also with more and more biometric data on chip cards and things like that, there are different aspects of cyber exposure for individuals, and a proper personal lines cyber policy should also take into account not only the online fraud, but also in general consequence out of a cyber attack, because getting ransomware out of a system, an individual like you and me might also need help from professionals, and also cyber policy will take care also that the restoration of certain data and put out the ransomware out of the system and decrypt the data. So all about services is similar to a commercial policy. You will also find in a personal line cyber policy coverage elements which takes care above a pure risk transfer. But also if you are a victim of, let's say, a cyber attack and you can't go to work because you have to fix certain things at home, there are also policies in place to take care of loss of income. But more importantly, when I said with healthcare data and the biometric data, also to recover your identity and things like that. And how it could work, and I close also, almost to give you an example, a practical example from a personal line cyber perspective, and especially when it comes to online fraud. And I mean, if a computer system or a smartphone of an individual gets hacked, and certainly credit card data or bank data gets stolen, the consequence from a loss perspective would be a financial loss. And as I said, the cover would not only take care of the financial loss, it would also take care of professional services to, on one hand, prevent further incidents, but also to prevent as a current incident. And it's also important that the insurance company reacts quickly from a claims management perspective. So you will see, most likely in almost all cases, that also a hotline is available, most likely 24 hours, 7 days a week, because everything around fraud and financial losses needs to be solved quite soon. And the expectation is to limit also from an individual perspective the potential downside. So we will also see quite a service approach from a claims handling perspective, but also from a post-incident response, as an example for online fraud. But also, it's not about only the fraud. The commercial area, as I said before, was in the first two quarters of 2017 largely affected by ransomware, but also with WannaCry and Petya, also the individuals were affected with ransomware. And to really get an idea of ransomware, when your personal files are encrypted and you can't use it, you also need certain support from experts to decrypt your files and to where to use it. And also, to a certain extent, it depends if you also have your own business, certainly, and rely heavily on the IT, you need a proper and a fast fixing of the problem. And also here in the cyber extortion space, for the individuals, it's certainly the ransomware, which will be paid either in Bitcoin or whatever currency, but also a proper and fast response to get the things fixed. That's in a nutshell where we see from a financial sector perspective the positives around the digitalization, especially when it comes to IT connectivity, to the usage of webs and the new payment methods, but also having a look to the threat actors in this space and how a proper risk assessment should happen, and what kind of solutions from a commercial but also personal line perspective you can expect from the insurance market, and especially also here in India, for instance, from HDFC-ERGO. Thank you for your attention. Any questions so far? Thank you.